Tyson, do you? How do you adjust to life?
You never adjust to this. You never adjust. That's what it's designed to do. I believe, as I see this, prison is designed to have you adjust. Have you adjust to being an animal? Because it may not seem because you're adjusted, but it's, you know, I mean, this is a form of, if you could say, a circus, an animal taming like environment. And we say we have to adjust in order to survive, but in any kind of environment that you're in, even though if you're outside, anybody that actually obeys authority is not actually free.
So is it designed then to keep you in place?
More so, okay. Yeah.
Do you think it's supposed to produce a citizen who comes out better than when he went in? Will it do that?
Not my opinion. My opinion only that I base, it doesn't rehabilitate you more, so debilitate you. Because I find myself doing things that I never dreamed I'd be capable of doing.
Like?
Or saying things that I never think I'd be capable of saying.
Like?
Well, you know, I mean, just basically responding to somebody in a way that's not as pleasant as it would normally be, say, outside, if you're in a more cultivated environment.
Or is you treated less than a human?
Yeah, we have those days. Yeah, we have those not-to-be-human-treated days.
And is that at the whim of people?
You know, I mean, if you want to evaluate, since you've never been in this predicament,
never.
Just say you have somebody just hold, and not say humiliate you, just say somebody grab you and just put you on the ground and hold you there. And just, you can't get up when you want to get up.
And that could happen at any time?
Basically, yeah.
So that's, what was the 24-hour cycle?
Yeah, but you have to understand that. Do you do any writing?
Sure.
Sometimes you could be in your room writing, you're in peace, and someone can come, an absolute stranger, a new guard could come in, open your door and start checking through your things as you're writing, and going under your blanket, checking for something that we call
shakedown. What are they
looking
for?
I don't know, contraband, drugs, and... But, you know, worse than that, it comes to a state where you act as if they're not even near you. You just continue to write.
In other words, you tune it out.
Yeah. Wow. I never tune it out, though. I always, for some reason, I always have to rebel some kind of way. That's just, I only do that to keep my state of mind. To make myself believe I'm still human. I just have to rebel sometimes. There's repercussions from it, but I just have to.
Is there any, Mike, self-blame? Is there any time you say, I caused what happened, even though I may be innocent, there's a part of me that caused me to be here?
Well, there's no doubt about it. We write our own story in life. Whatever we do, whatever good we do in life, we get good in return. Whatever ill we do, we get ill in return. There's no doubt about it.
So you think you're paying for something now?
Well, I think I've used bad judgment, and I mean, I had to deal with the circumstances that I don't believe was normally a fair circumstance, but regardless, it was a circumstance that I have to deal with.
So there's no bitterness? Or is there?
I'm not bitterness, but, you know, this is one time I would like to have a little revenge, you know what I mean? I always go from this perspective. Whatever happens, you know what I mean? And sometimes you hit me with your best shot and we see how I handle it. But when the same thing happens to you, we must always remember never to take it personal. I never take this personal. And that's how I used to look at my life. I used to never take it personal, because eventually one day we'll grow old and we'll die, and then we won't have to worry about anyone thinks or say about us any longer.
How about anger at the woman?
I'm not angry. I'm not angry at it. I just despise the actions.
But not angry, nor is you
want
to see her harmed?
No, not at all. You know what I mean? It wouldn't bring me any benefit to see her harmed or hurt, but it just... Let me see, if I were to put in this frame, I would say, I admire the act of treachery, but I hate a traitor. And it's just the fact that, you know what I mean, for someone to take someone's life, you know, you really never know until you actually spent the amount of time in prison. This is only 2 years for me. And you realize, they are vicious people. We use the word vicious like a vicious person, but vicious is very malice, attack malicely. And it's just to obliviate someone's life and their family's life.
The thought outside would be that Mike Tyson, even in here, is king of the hill. He's former heavyweight champ. The correctional office must respect him. The warden must, respect athletic ability. There must be a sense of admiration here.
Well, because I'm Mike Tyson, former heavyweight champion, that gives them more reason to despise me. You must understand, we're not in New York City where I roamed, in Los Angeles or Paris prisons where I used to roam the streets buying everyone champagne and going in the clubs and living a gay life. I'm just saying, we're in a very lethargic type of atmosphere where there's a great deal of people that are confused because they don't understand. They've never been around someone like me. They never hardly experienced being around minorities in general. So, you know, I mean, they look at me kind of funny, but they also despise me.
Despise?
Exactly.
Don't hold you in awe.
No.
How old are you now?
27.
That's very young. Very young. Do you feel very young?
I feel great.
You do?
Yeah.
All right, I want to touch a lot of bases. The new heavyweight champ, did you see the fight?
No, I didn't witness the fight.
Before we talk about the champ, give me the schedule. Like, what time they get you up here?
I go to school at 8 o'clock. And after 8 o'clock, we come back at 3:15, and we go to rec. And it's just very, I mean...
Same thing every day?
Mundane type situation every day.
What time you go to bed?
11 o'clock, 11:30.
Do they let you, if you want to wake up in the middle of the night and read, can
you? Yeah, we do that. You have to read in a very dark, dim light. I guess that's the torture chamber. Like, you know, in old Spain, in the Spaniards, they used to have those lights that it's on all night. I guess it was designed to make you go crazy.
And dripping water. They don't do that.
No, it's just cold. And I know heat.
You have gotten a lot into reading, right?
Yeah.
Why?
I don't know. You know what? I used to read only boxing magazines. And then from reading the boxing magazines, you may read about a great writer may have quoted a fighter. I mean, he may have been very friendly because George Bernard Shaw, believe it or not, was very friendly with Gene Tony. You know what I mean? And then that just made me...
Great writers are attracted to fighters, always have been.
I never knew that.
Norman Mailer was intrigued with boxing.
I knew that.
Yeah.
But Noah, I read a guy by the name of Homer, and he wrote about a guy, Achilles and Hector, and he wrote about that war. Even though it was so many years ahead of his time, it's been passed down, and he told the story. And I'm sure that things have been exchanged from all those years, but the story, he said it like as if he was there. And I just like reading. I like reading about the writers and the boxers, how they have so much in common.
So you're now reading a lot?
I've burnt out slightly, but you know, every now and then I go back and forth.
I think Pete Hamill wrote in Esquire that you were reading the classics.
Yeah.
Like you mentioned Homer, you're reading others?
Yeah, I read quite a few.
And modern novels too?
Not too many. Unless someone, a modern author sends me his book and I read it.
What do you do with your mind in a place of confinement? You know, you confine everything but your mind. You can't confine someone's mind.
And I think that's the only state of you that's actually free at all, even when you're out in the streets. It's the only thing because, as we know, that we have neutrons in our brain, and our body's only purpose is to carry our brain. It's just to carry our brain. And from that perspective only, that I believe that we live. It's for our brain to absorb knowledge because there's really no wise men in this world. Because as you know, knowledge is just everlasting. The only wise man is God. So I believe we have to look for God within ourselves and just use common sense.
Have you found a new faith out of this?
Meaning what?
Did you change faiths? Did you change your opinion of faith?
No, I just always had a great deal of belief. I was very confused with God because I was in a world where everything was material to me. So if I didn't see God, I couldn't believe, how could I actually believe God? I was almost in the same mentality as the drug dealer. His God was money, his God was what he believed in, the bullet, a gun. Not that I believed in killing or shooting, but I believed more like finance and what the finance could bring you. But then again, you have to just use something that's very simple. Like you look at an eagle, he could be 300 feet in the air and they can see a field mouse. And we can't see a field mouse if he's 10 feet away from us. So if he could see a field mouse from up there, our eyes are not properly programmed for us to see God. Maybe God is not meant for us to see, but he's there.
We'll be right back with Mike Tyson after this. We left the subject of religion during the break and started to talk about Joe Louis being buried in Arlington Cemetery, and you were a great admirer, no, Joe Louis.
Exactly.
His son wrote a book about it. And then you mentioned some fighter who's brave you'd like to visit.
Yeah, for instance, there was a fighter by the name of Jack Blackburn. He was Joe Louis' trainer. And he was a great fighter also. He never won the title. And the reason why is because another fighter at that time was named Joe Gans that was just magnificent. No one could touch him. He was impossible to beat.
All right, so you have faith in a God, right?
Allah, yes.
Allah. So now you were raised Catholic. That's been a switch, hasn't it?
Yes.
How did that happen? Did it happen here?
Yeah, you know what? Let's go back to Catholic. I was raised Catholic basically in my home in Brooklyn. But at that particular time, I was running the streets. Religion never had no impact on me. Then I met Don King. Then he basically put me in this situation, a state of religion. He thought it would be good. But I wasn't. I was champ of the world. I was in another state.
You didn't need that, Jazz.
I didn't need that stuff. And plus, I didn't understand it. So being in here put me in a confinement, put me in a situation to understand Islam, to become a Muslim, and be probably becoming a Muslim, and to know the situation of the Muslims in this world, and we're becoming extinct. And because other Muslims are allowing it to happen. But you have to understand, there's always there's religion, but there's always a contradiction in religion. Where you look at one set of people who's supposed to be the same belief, have the same belief as another set, but we preach totally different. But who are we to say who's wrong? But who are we to doubt someone else's faith?
You study this a lot then?
Yes.
What do you think of what's going on out there in the world with the Farrakhans and the like?
I personally, as a personal man, you know what I mean, people differ with me. I absolutely love Farrakhan. I don't know the gentleman by the name of Khalid Muhammad, but Farrakhan as a person, I love Farrakhan. And it's very easy for a person to judge someone for what they say, but a real wise man will never have ill feelings of the speaker, but to take in heed what he says. If what he says is true, you know what I mean, you must correct yourself. And if it's not true, you must prevent it from happening.
But if he's wrong, you should correct him.
If the man's wrong, then what he says has no significance.
You don't carry around harsh feelings based on race, do you?
No.
Did you ever?
Out of ignorance, yes.
So out of ignorance, you were once like anti-white or anti-Jew or anti...
No, never that. Because if I wouldn't know, by looking at a white person, I wouldn't know if anyone in here is Jewish, Irish, Catholic, or Italian. You know what I mean? It's just that we don't know. We don't know, and we're influenced. And that's why I believe that people are so much have to differ with Mr. Farrakhan, because the minister, they're afraid that the minister can control somebody's thinking, just like some people in the media controls the thinking of people. They feel now they have to compete with somebody for the minds of these people. And he perhaps is giving them a run for their money without the sophistication that they have, using the television, using the cameras.
So you think he frightens them?
He makes them uneasy, yeah. I believe that.
Yourself, what do you miss the most?
Oh, man, you just ask me. I don't know. I never think about anything.
You don't
too much when you're in here.
Think about women?
I had a problem with that one time. When I first came here, I was a little upraised. I used to be very much, oh, what's happening here on the phone? And you're very uncomfortable in that whole situation. And if whatever happens, happens. Listen, they're out there. They're not mad, so why should I be mad? If they're not mad, I'm not mad. They have to live their life.
You miss bonding.
Huh?
Do you miss other people, touching, holding? Yeah, things, I mean, people miss.
Every time I was in that situation where I would bond with somebody, I had no other significance but to bond. And after that, it was emptiness. So what is the purpose of really thinking about it? Because it would be the same as being in prison if there's no actual feelings there. Because then again, we go on a subject, really, we don't know what is love. Who knows what is love? You know what I mean? I'm not in a position to say what is love.
But you've experienced love, attention. You've had that wonderful lady that helped raise you, right?
Yeah, but we were talking about love from a different perspective. Okay. You said women.
All right,
you
didn't romantic say family. Love.
Romantic.
You can miss romantic love.
Maybe, but what is love? Love is like a game. Love is competition. It's competition. Most people who's gorgeous, a guy or a woman maybe, love comes to them all the time because they attract love. But what they never fought for love, then what are they prepared to do for love? You know what I mean? Love is that a situation where you must be prepared to do something, because if you have something lovely, somebody's going to want to challenge you for it. And if you've never been competitive enough, the slightest struggle, you're going to give in.
Obviously, you're gaining better control of your own total environment here. What about food? You miss certain foods. You miss certain... No?
I'm trying to
put the audience into what would it be like just, not to have the things they have every day.
I don't know. I'm just, you know, because you're in a situation, there's people out in the street that've been to prison, and perhaps a lot worse than the situation I'm in, but you become so much attached to you. You're very much attached to you. You know what I mean? It comes a time where everybody with you, I believe, that somebody, a writer by name, he's a playwright named Tennessee Williams, said, we must distrust one another because that's the only way we could protect each other from betrayal. And I'm a great believer in that.